band recitals.
Jan, tonight we are joined in the Levin Performance Studio by the members of the Galvin Cello Quartet. See how he, Haddon Kay, Sidney Lee, and Luis Fernando Venturelli. Miraculously, the group was founded during the pandemic and quickly won the silver medal at the Fischhoff competition in 2021. We'll hear more of their story later, but first music. And the first work to be performed tonight is a youthful piece by Mozart. He wrote the Divertimento in D major, K-136, in Salzburg during the winter of 1772. This piece and two others, also composed around this time, were probably intended as light dinner or party entertainment in the homes of Salzburg's noble families. Often Mozart himself could be found playing at the keyboard or in the string ensemble at these occasions. It should also be mentioned that these works were probably influenced by Mozart's recent trip to Italy, and the form of these pieces follows that of the Italian Sinfonia, namely three movements in the pattern of fast, slow, fast. And in this specific case, they are marked allegro, andante, and presto. Here then is the Galvin Cello Quartet to open our live broadcast with the Divertimento in D major, K-136, by Mozart. Thank you. We just heard the Galvin Cello Quartet in their own arrangement of Mozart's Divertimento in D Major, K-136. Much more to come on this live broadcast featuring the Galvin Cello Quartet. Next up, music by Bach, the famous Chaconne from the solo violin Partita No. 2 in D Minor. The Chaconne form originated as a dance in Mexico. It was brought to Europe in the 16th century, and in the classical form, it's essentially a ground bass in triple meter with a melodic line layered on top, which is then repeated and varied. Bach's Chaconne was supposedly written to honor the death of his wife, and it is the only Chaconne he wrote, and it definitely packs an emotional wallop. Brahms, in writing to Clara Schumann, said, "On the stave, for a small instrument, the man writes a whole world of the deepest thoughts and most powerful feelings. If I imagined that I could have created, even conceived such a piece, I'm quite certain that the excess of excitement and earth-shattering experience would have driven me out of my mind." Initially, this final massive movement was, as I mentioned, part of the solo violin Partita for number 2, but it now stands alone as a piece which has been transcribed for many instruments, and it certainly works well in arrangements for various ensembles because it contains extensive polyphony and implied counterpoint. This arrangement is by Laszlo Varga. Here is the Chaconne from the Partita No. 2 in D minor by Bach, played by the Galvin Cello Quartet.
Thank you.
Le Chaconne from Bach's Partita No. 2 in D minor, BWV 1004. And the arrangement for cello quartet by Laszlo Varga. And we heard the Galvin cello quartet perform it tonight on Live from WFMT. We have one more piece before we take a break, and it's by Rossini, who of course was one of the best known and most prolific composers of opera of all time. But this piece dates from after all of that, much later in his life. It's from an extensive set of pieces written late in his life called Sins of My Old Age, dating from the 1860s. The title of this piece is Una Larme, and that is a reference to a tear, and it implies a certain sadness of the theme's tone. The tune was probably written to honor a recently deceased friend. This is a statement of the theme and a set of variations. And again, this is an arrangement by Laszlo Varga. This is the variations on Una Larme from Sins of My Old Age by Rossini, as played by the Galvin Cello Quartet. Theme and Variations on Una Larme by Rossini, in the arrangement by Laszlo Varga. We heard the Galvin Cello Quartet, and that ensemble is with us tonight on Live from WFMT. We're going to take a break now, but there is much more music to come. Do stay with us. Jan? We're back in the studio now with the Galvin Cello Quartet. Xiao He, Haddon Kay, Sidney Lee, and Luis Fernando Venturelli. And before we get to more music, I'd like to talk to the group a bit about how this all came together. And I have a feeling the gentleman sitting right over there had something to do with it, one Hans Jensen, a wonderful professor of cello at Northwestern University. So tell me, how in the world did you focus have this wonderful idea to come together and play?
It was actually Sydney's idea. She's the one who kind of brought it to our attention, since we had to do chamber music at Northwestern, but you know, of course it was during the pandemic, so it was hard to make contact with other people. But since we are already kind of in our own little bubble hanging out, Sydney kind of suggested maybe we play chamber music with each other for fun.
Well, because also I've done a lot of like cello ensembles in the past, and I just really loved doing them, but never really got a chance to take one seriously. So I was thinking to myself, like, oh, well, what better time than now to form a really serious cello quartet, since the level at Mr. Jensen's studio is so high. I thought it would be really fun to play together, and since we were, like Haddon said, since we were like spending a lot of time together during the pandemic, I just thought it would be a really great opportunity to get to play together and play a lot of fun music.
But, you know, if you're going to be a quartet that really works, there has to be some sort of simpatico between the four of you, certainly. And you don't know that until you really start doing it, right? It sounds like it's worked out pretty well.
I mean, in some ways we knew, because we've known each other for a very long time. I've known Siho for close to 10 years now, and Sydney and Haddon for 5-6 years each, but it was our first time playing together, so it, in that sense we didn't know, but it did work out really well. We get along really well.
Well, I think the crazy part about our story is that, like Luis mentioned, we all knew each other, but then we've never played together.
Right.
And so when we first started, the thing that we, I guess, had in mind was to enter Fish Off.
Mm-hmm.
And that was due like beginning of March, but then Luis was still at home in Brazil while we were in Evanston. And so we were like, come over here to Evanston. And of course, like during that time, it was a little bit tricky with all the quarantine. So by the time that he was finished with quarantining and we could actually start rehearsing, we had about 11 days to put together 40 minutes of music.
Oh my gosh.
So it was quite an adventure, but it definitely was a bonding moment for us. And yeah, I think it was a little stressful, but we also had a lot of fun along the way.
Yeah, and you won the silver medal. So you must have done something right. Well, that's really fantastic. What plans do you have in terms of keeping this together for a while and, you know, touring perhaps?
We're all going to be still at Northwestern as students in the next year, but we've been working with CAG, the Concert Artists Guild.
Mm-hmm.
We recently were winners of the Victor Elmale competition, so we've been managed by them. So we have a few concerts lined up for the next two seasons, and yeah.
We actually just did a concert in Michigan, Heart Michigan.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we enjoy the place, and then we enjoy the crowd, and then we had such fun playing for the audience.
Of course, when you do more concerts, you're going to have to find more repertoire. And that can be a little tricky for cellos, I would imagine. What are you doing in that regard?
Well, yeah, that's actually probably the trickiest part of our ensemble, is that there's very, very few pieces written originally for cello quartet. Actually, the next piece you'll hear, I'll talk more about it later, but it's the only original cello quartet on our first program.
Mm-hmm.
So this year we're playing the program you're hearing right now. And we have a couple programs lined up, but usually we tend to find arrangements, but we also plan on trying to commission some works. One of our goals is to commission works from each one of our cultural backgrounds, as kind of this cello quartet has brought us all together from around the world, Brazil, China, and Sydney and I from the US.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that's kind of things we're looking forward to in terms of repertoire and pieces and also playing together. So.
Well, we hope you'll come back with some of that new repertoire.
We hope so.
Someday
to.
Soon. Okay. You mentioned the next piece, and this is the only piece on the program which was actually written for four cellos.
Yes.
So tell us about this piece and about Wilhelm Fitzhagen.
Yeah, this is Fitzhagen's Ave Maria, and it was actually one of the first pieces we read together, I believe, when we were preparing for Fish Off. So this piece is actually very special to us. It's such a spiritual and reflective piece, so I just hope that you can enjoy and it can calm your soul. We really enjoy this piece, and it has a very special place in our hearts.
All right, let's hear it. This is music by Wilhelm Fitzhagen, who was a great cellist himself, and as a matter of fact, he wrote this piece because he was a member of the German Lutheran Church in Moscow. And this was one of many pieces that he wrote for the services. It's the Ave Maria, Opus 41 by Wilhelm Fitzhagen. That was music by Wilhelm Fitzenhagen, the Ave Maria, his Opus 41, played by the Galvin Cello Quartet. We have next some music having to do with Argentina, and the first music is by Astor Piazzolla. Piazzolla was born in a suburb of Buenos Aires, and he spent his childhood in New York City. Eventually, he studied in Paris with Nadia Boulanger, who told him to write what he knew and what he loved, specifically the tango. He created a synthesis between the tango and classical forms. This is a fugue which was written for a play called Tango del Angel, and it was about an angel who came down to earth and attempted to heal the human spirit, but instead wound up being stabbed. So this is La Muerte del Angel from Piazzolla's Angel series. And following that, we're going to hear music by Carlos Gardel, whom Piazzolla greatly admired. And Gardel was born in France, but he grew up in Argentina and became a legendary voice of the tango on numerous recordings and in 11 films. He was a very dramatic and seductive presence. He died in his mid-40s in a plane crash. And this is one of his most famous songs. It's lyrics written by Alfredo Lapera. The song is called Por una Carbeta, or By a Head. And this is a reference to someone who's obsessed with racehorses and also with women. And the song compares both of those obsessions. And we're going to hear both of these pieces now as played by the Galvin Cello Quartet. So first, Piazzolla's La Muerte del Angel, and then Por una Carbeza by Carlos Gardel. Thank you. We heard first Astor Piazzolla's La Muerte del Angel in an arrangement by Blaise Desjardins, and after that music by Carlos Gardel for Una Cerveza in the arrangement by James Barrelet for Cello Quartet, played by the Galvin Cello Quartet, our guests tonight, live from WFMT. Video of tonight's performance, by the way, can be found at WFMT.com or WFMT's Facebook and YouTube channels. We have next music by George Gershwin, The Three Preludes, which date from 1926 and were originally written for piano, but they've been arranged by many different people for many different ensembles. And we're going to talk to Louise about this set of pieces before we hear them. And actually, Louise, the first one has a sort of Latin tinge to it, I would say, right?
Oh, yeah. More specifically, it's very heavily influenced by the bayon, which is a rhythmic pattern found in very traditional northeastern Brazilian music. Mm-hmm. So this is one of the reasons why this piece is so special to me personally, because it really is just rhythm from back home. But not only that, both of my parents are pianists, and my dad is and has always been very obsessed with Gershwin. And I remember that was some of the first music he ever showed me as a kid. And he showed me a lot of original piano Gershwin music, but also arranged for orchestra, arranged for different types of instruments. And I think that really had an impact on me as a musician, because Gershwin does such a fantastic job transitioning between jazz and classical music and combining everything together in a cohesive way. And that had a really strong impact on who I became as a musician. So this is a really special piece for me and for us. We arranged this one ourselves, and we went through a lot of different versions of it. This is version number 8 or 9. Mm-hmm. And it's a fairly recent arrangement. We finished this about a month and a half ago, but it's really special to us.
All right, let's hear it. We'll hear The Three Preludes now by George Gershwin in the arrangement and performance by the Galvin Cello Quartet. Thank you. The Three Preludes by George Gershwin, the Galvin Cello Quartet's arrangement and performance. We have two pieces to conclude this evening. They're both by one of the greatest cellists of all time, and certainly a gentleman that any cellist knows perhaps all too well after practicing his etudes over and over again, namely David Popper. We're going to hear his Concert Polonaise and Elfentanz, and Cindy Lee is going to tell us a bit about those two pieces. But first, I don't mean to throw you a curveball, but there certainly is something about the sound of a cello quartet which is just quite wonderful. And you wouldn't think that would be the case. You wouldn't think four of the same instruments playing to you would have such a remarkable effect on you. What is it? Is it the range of possibilities of the instrument? But something is very moving and, so we say, deeply resonant about the whole thing.
Yeah, I think for me, just the cello itself, it really resembles the human voice. Mm. And I think, honestly, well, it's a little biased, but I think the cello is the coolest instrument because we can do everything, like all the way down here, like low C string, and all the way up here on the A string. So I feel like we get like the best of like the violin and the bass together. And so it's, I don't know, for me, just the blend of the cellos is really heartwarming. And it's just, yeah, it's just so much fun.
I think there are a lot of folks out there that agree right about now. Let's hear this music of David Popper. Tell us about him and this arrangement of these two pieces.
Yeah, so the last two pieces that we'll be playing are the Popper's Polonaise and Popper's Dance of the Elves. And both of them are actually works for cello and piano that have been arranged for four cellos. Similar to the Fitzenhagen, the Polonaise was actually one of our first pieces we played together, so it really has a special place for us. And yeah, it's very virtuosic, both pieces, so it's a lot of fun for the audience to hear, and it's a lot of fun for us to play as well. So
okay.
I hope you'll enjoy it.
Concert Polonaise, Opus 14, and Elfentanz, the Elf's Dance, both by David Popper. Thank you. Two pieces by David Popper. We heard first the Concert Polonaise in D minor, opus 14, and then Elfentanz, the Elves Dance, opus 39. The first in an arrangement by Sebastian von Eck, and the second in an arrangement by Blaise Desjardins. And both performed by the Galvin Cello Quartet. That music bringing us to the end of this live concert by them. The members being Xiao He, Haron Kay, Sidney Lee, and Luis Fernando Venturelli. If you'd like to know more about the group and its endeavors, please do visit their website, galvincellocartet.com. And if you'd like to see video related to tonight's performance, you can go to WFMT.com or visit WFMT's Facebook or YouTube channels. Our thanks to these fine musicians for this very enjoyable concert tonight. Thanks also to my co-producer, Louise Frank, and to our music producer, Max LeBien. We had assistance tonight from Ella Pinsloot. Next week, as the series continues, we will hear from the great flutist Marina Piccinini and the equally great Sergio and Clarice Assad. I'm Kerry Frumkin, host and producer of these programs, hoping you'll be with us again next Monday night at 8 for more music and performance live from WFMT.